Welcome back. In this video, we shall discuss on elementary signals. Okay. Elementary signals are required basically to construct more complex signals. Okay. Using these elementary signals, we can construct more complicated signals. First, we shall discuss continuous time. And later on, we'll go with the discrete time. Okay. So first elementary signal is exponential signal. So it is of the form x of t, y t, because we are talking in terms of continuous time. Okay. So if it is discrete time, we will be having x of n, small letter n. So it is of the form x of t is equal to a constant c times e power a t. So where c is the constant, okay, and a is also a constant, right? Now c is actually amplitude of the signal. C is actually amplitude of this exponential signal x of t at time t is equal to 0. Fine. At t is equal to 0, the amplitude of the signal will be c. Okay. Now we have two cases in a. If a is less than 0, in the sense if a is negative, the signal is exponentially decreasing. If a is less than 0, obviously, right? Because a is less than 0 in the sense negative, so e power minus t is exponentially decreasing signal, right? So if a is positive, if a is greater than 0, so it is exponentially increasing. So graphically, this is how exponentially decreasing signal looks like. This is at t is equal to 0. What is the amplitude? Amplitude is c, right? Because e power 0 is 1. 1 into c, I get c. Amplitude is c. So this is the independent variable t. Here a is what? Positive or negative? Since it's exponentially decreasing, a is negative. If a is negative, it is exponentially decreasing signal, right? So this is nothing but x of t, which is equal to c times e power minus a t. If a is positive, this is how the signal looks like. So it is exponentially increased, right? So at t is equal to 0, amplitude is constant c. It is t. So this is for a is greater than 0. Okay. So this is the exponential signal. This is about the exponential signal. So now we shall talk about the sinusoidal signal. Now, not a big deal, right? It is of the form x of t is equal to amplitude a into cos or sine, anything is fine, omega naught t plus phi, right? So I hope you know these parameters. What is a? A is the instantaneous amplitude of the signal, right? And what is omega naught? It is frequency, angular frequency, and omega naught is actually 2 pi f naught, where f naught is hertz, frequency in hertz. This is in radians per second, right? Now what is t? T is the independent variable. It is independent variable. So now what is this phi? Plus or minus phi, right? It is phase shift. Phase shift of the signal. Okay. Now this is in terms of fundamental time. So I can write it as 2 pi by t, right? Because t naught, because f naught is equal to 1 by t naught. Okay, so this is about sinusoidal signal. So next is third elementary signal, exponential damped sinusoidal signal. Exponentially damped sinusoidal signal. So this is of the form x of t is equal to e power minus a t sine of omega t. So where a is greater than 0 here. Why a is greater than 0? Because since we have minus, so since it is exponentially damped, so it has to be exponentially decreasing. So here I need negative, so that's why we made the condition a should be positive. Okay. So this is basically multiplication of two signal. One is exponentially decreasing signal with a sinusoidal signal, right? So what is the resultant signal if that is the case? So resultant signal will be, so from plus 1 to minus 1, since it's a sine wave, so it will be exponentially decreasing. The signal will be exponentially decreasing like this. And this amplitude goes to 0 at t is equal to infinity. Okay. So t is equal to 0. This is t. Next, fourth elementary signal. Fourth one. It is unit step function. Unit step function. So it is of the form u of t is equal to, we have discussed it, right? So it is 1 for t greater than or equal to 0 and equal to 0 otherwise. If I graphically, it is 40 greater less than 0, it is 0, 40 greater than 0, it is 1. So this is u of t. Why it is called as unit step? Because at t is equal to 0, abruptly I have a step here with an amplitude of 1. So that's why it is called as unit step function. Okay. Fifth elementary signal, unit ramp function. Unit ramp function. Again, we have discussed this, right? So it is of the form small letter r of t is what? It is t. For t greater than or equal to 0 and equal to 0 otherwise. Okay, so graphically it is something like this. For t less than 0, it is 0. For t greater than 0, so its slope is 1. Okay, so this is t, this is r of t. At t is equal to 1, amplitude is 1. At t is equal to 2, amplitude is 2. At t is equal to 3, amplitude is 3, and this goes on. Fine. So, and the slope here is, it has a unit slope. So that's why it is called as unit ramp function. Okay. Next, the sixth elementary signal is, sixth one. So unit impulse function. Unit impulse function. So this is important. So it is denoted by delta of t. Okay, unit impulse function is denoted by delta of t, and it's defined by delta of t is equal to 0 for t not equal to 0. So it is 0 for t not equal to 0, or in other words, I can say, just to avoid confusion, delta of t is, it has an impulse of unit area at t is equal to 0. At t is equal to 0, it has an impulse of unit area and is equal to 0 otherwise. And equal to 0 other class. Okay, you can make use of this equation or this equation. This is a bit confusing, but this, by looking at the definition itself, I can say at t is equal to 0, it has an impulse and is 0 otherwise. Okay, so before we just go in deep detail with this delta function, so the condition here is, if I integrate this delta of t with respect to t, for t varying from minus infinity to infinity, okay, so this will give, this should give me unit area. This is the condition here. So if I integrate minus from minus infinity to infinity delta of t, it has to give me the value 1. So integrating in this instance, what? Area under the curve, right? So basically what happens now? So if I just try to plot this, say, so I reached infinity line here. This is minus infinity and this is plus infinity. Okay, this is at t is equal to 0. Now, so say I reached infinity and the amplitude here is almost 0. I cannot say 0. So for t varying from minus infinity to infinity, it is almost 0. Okay, so it is 0 in such a way that if I integrate it from minus infinity to infinity, okay, if I integrate it from minus infinity to infinity, so I should get unit area. Fine. Now, what I'll do, starting from minus infinity to infinity, I'll try to compress it. I'll keep on compressing it. So, the condition here is, when I compress it, so it has to follow this condition. So, it has to have the unit area. Okay. So, what happens if I try to compress it? Say, I'll come at a point, from minus infinity, I'll come at a point at A, and from plus infinity, I'll come at a point of B. So, since I was compressing it and I have to make sure that the area is unit, so what happens to the amplitude actually? Before, it was amplitude was almost approximately equal to 0. Now, since I'm compressing it and I have to maintain unit area, so what happens to the amplitude? Amplitude rises. Amplitude rises in such a way that area under this curve should hold unit area 1. Okay. Now, I'll still compress it. So what happens if I come at this point A and at this point B? So what happens to the amplitude? Amplitude increases. Why amplitude is getting increased? Because I have to maintain area under the curve, which is unity, right? Now I'll compress more. Here it is A, here it is B. So what happens to the amplitude? Again, amplitude is getting increased. Now I'll keep on compressing it, this rectangular pulse, keep on compressing it, in such a way that the width of this rectangular pulse is almost equal to 0. I repeat again, I'll keep on compressing this width of the rectangular pulse such a way that the width reaches almost equal to 0. Okay, if the width of this reaches almost equal to 0, what happens to the amplitude? So amplitude is an impulse which goes to infinity, right? So it is something like this. So at t is equal to 0, I have an impulse which is reaching infinity. Okay, which is reaching infinity. And mind you, if I integrate this, I should get unit area. Here also this condition should satisfy. So that's why I told delta of t is what? Impulse. It's an impulse of unit area at t is equal to 0 and equal to 0 otherwise. Okay, now the three characteristics of impulse function is delta of t is, first one, it has zero width, right? And second one, it has, what is the height? It is infinite, no? Infinite height. And the third characteristics is, what is the area under the curve? So it has unit area. It has unit area. Okay. So this is about unit impulse function. Why it is called as unit? Because the area is actually unit. That's why. Okay. In discrete time, this is in continuous time, okay. So in discrete time, the unit impulse function is delta of n, and this is actually 1. It's a sample, 1 instead of impulse of unit area, it is just 1, okay, at n equal to 0 and equal to 0 otherwise. So this is how unit impulse function is defined in discrete time. Okay, it is basically not impulse of unit area, it is basically a sample at sample of value 1 at n equal to 0 and equal to 0 otherwise. Okay, so graphically, delta of n is defined actually at n equal to 0, its amplitude is 1 and equal to 0 otherwise. Now, seventh one, so it is rectangular function. So again, we have discussed it. So it is of the form RECT of t, small letter t, RECT of t, and it is given by, it is 1 for t, varying from minus 1 by 2 to plus 1 by 2 and equal to 0 otherwise. Okay, so graphically, so minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 and its amplitude is 1. This is how RECT of t, rectangular pulse, looks like. Fine. Now let me discuss one last signal, which is actually sync function. So this is an important function which we will be discussing in Fourier series and Fourier transform. So for time being, we'll just define it. So it is of the form SINC of t. Left hand side is SINC of t. It's a function of t, is given by sine of pi into t divided by pi into t. Okay. So graphically, at t is equal to 0, so its amplitude is 1. Okay, so for integer multiples of t, so it will cross the 0. So this is at t is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so on. This is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, and this goes. Okay, so this is how the sync function looks like. So this sync function plays a major role in actually Fourier transformation, which we shall discuss later. Thank you.